Between June 1941 and February 1942, the Third Reich and the Soviet Union clashed in a titanic struggle which changed the course of history. In the battle for Russia, the German Wehrmacht, the most highly trained and successful military machine on Earth, attempted to defeat the Red Army and win for Germany a vast Eastern Empire. The result was a collision of unprecedented violence. Beginning with the German invasion and culminating in the fight for Moscow, more men, tanks, guns and aircraft were committed to the inferno than had ever before been thrown into any battle. With each side led by an unscrupulous dictator and each army driven by a pitiless ideology, war was waged with a ferocity and barbarism up to then unimaginable. To Adolf Hitler, the assault on the Soviet Union was meant to bring a victory unmatched in the annals of warfare. In reality, the battle for Russia would end in disaster for Germany. Instead of a lightning conquest, the Wehrmacht would suffer a catastrophic defeat, a defeat that would mark the beginning of the end for Hitler's Reich. In Moscow, on August the 23rd, 1939, Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union signed an agreement which shocked the world. The Third Reich, the most violently anti-communist regime in existence, had agreed to cooperate with Stalin's dictatorship. Each undertook not to attack the other, and huge quantities of Soviet food, oil and minerals would be exchanged for German manufactured goods. There was also a secret protocol, a protocol which assigned to Germany and Russia their own spheres of influence in Europe, areas in which the other would not interfere. For Adolf Hitler, the agreement came just in time. His armies were already massing on the Polish border, and he needed an absolute assurance from the Russians that they would not intervene if he invaded. 8 days after the signing of the Nazi-Soviet pact, German armies surged across Polish frontiers. For the Poles, struggling desperately in the face of the Nazi tide, the German-Soviet pact quickly took on a chilling reality. 2 weeks into the battle, the Red Army invaded Poland from the east. With German connivance, the Soviets were to take more than half the country. Within a few days of Hitler's attack on Poland, Britain and France had declared war on Germany. To Joseph Stalin, the sight of the great European powers at each other's throats was deeply satisfying. It was a priceless opportunity to seize yet more territory with little fear of opposition. Anxious to strengthen his northern flank, Stalin demanded strategically important areas of Finland. He was refused, and on November the 30th, 1939, 29 divisions of the Red Army attacked across Finnish borders. Russian forces were deployed in 5 armies. In the south, the main blow was struck by 7th and 13th armies pushing across the Karelian Isthmus. To the world's amazement, the Finns checked the advance. In the north, the Russian 14th Army cut off the port of Petsamo on the Arctic coast, a strategically important nickel mining area. However, in the center, the Soviets suffered humiliating defeats. The most costly when a penetration by 9th Army was completely cut off and destroyed. The battle for Finland lasted 4 months, during which a Finnish army of only 9 divisions fought with exceptional determination. The terrain was a wilderness of lakes and forests, greatly favoring the defenders. And it was only when the Soviets brought up another 11 divisions, more armor and heavy air power, that the Red Army made a significant breakthrough. In March 1940, the Finns were forced to sue for peace. To the Red Army, which had thrown 1 million men into the battle, the cost of the Finnish war was almost 200,000 killed. But the real damage was even greater. In the eyes of the world, the much vaunted Soviet armed forces looked incompetent and utterly ineffective. Less than a month after the end of the Soviet-Finnish war, Adolf Hitler launched his own campaign of conquest in Scandinavia. On April the 9th, Norway and Denmark were invaded by land, sea, and air. The invasions were carried out with ruthless efficiency. The Germans had complete control of the skies, and in spite of interventions by the British Royal Navy and a Franco-British Expeditionary Force, within weeks, all of Denmark and most of Norway were in German hands. However, for the Western Allies, the worst blows were yet to come. On May the 10th, 1940, 7 German armies, spearheaded by powerful armored formations, struck at France and the Low Countries. For the campaign in the West, the Germans deployed 3 army groups. Army Group A in the center was given most of the armored formations. Facing the Wehrmacht were the Belgian and Dutch armies, 3 French army groups, and a highly mobile British Expeditionary Force. In the north, Army Group B swept into Holland and northern Belgium, drawing the French and